Hello, everyone. This is the 15th episode of the Soccer Nostalgia Talk Podcast. As always, this is Sean from Los Angeles, and I'm joined by Paul from Shipley in England. We are pleased to have Mr. Jo Araf for the second time on our podcast. We last interviewed Mr. Araf on our podcast on our episode 7 regarding the Mitropa Cup. The topic of this discussion will be about the pre-war Italy national team manager Vittorio Pozzo. Mr. Araf is an Italian from Milano and author of the Italian language book on the Austrian 1930s Wunderteam called Generazione Wunderteam, Ascesa e caduta della squadra delle meraviglie. Hello, Joe. Welcome Hello. Back. And thank you very much for participating in another interview.
No, thank you, Sean, and thank you everyone for listening to us.
Thank you. While the World Cup has been around for 90 years now, only one manager has actually managed to win the World Cup on two occasions. That honor belongs to Vittorio Pozzo, manager of the Italian national team in the 1920s and 30s into the 40s. He led the Squadra Azzurri in the pre-war and immediately post-war era. In fact, he is a rare coach to have won the World Cup and the Olympic title. He remains one of the greatest managers of that era of football amongst his contemporaries such as Hugo Meisel and Herbert Chapman. Pozzo was born in Turin on March 2, 1886, at a time where organized football and league football still did not exist in Italy. He was able to see the birth of football in his nation. What was his childhood and youth, as well as his studies at Manchester in England, like, and how did that influence him as a manager?
Pozzo was born in a city called Ponderano, a very small town near Biella. Biella is a town that not many know because it's not very popular down here. Not touristy, it's not big, but it's quite close to Turin. And that's quite important because Turin is the city where football was born in Italy, actually. The first teams that thrived in Italy thrived in Turin. The reason is that Turin was a very rich city at the time, and usually like English employees were sent to Milan, to Turin, and here, very close to where Pozzo was born, the first teams appeared. And Pozzo was a kid then, at the time, but after a few years, he would become one of the founding members of nowadays Torino. So he was born in a place where football was important and child. That's like in the first important step. After that, as you mentioned, actually, he went to England and he took a few years in France, Switzerland, and England. And he also spent a spell in Germany. He said, of course, that the football that impressed him the most was the English one. And it is easy to... Can you hear me well now?
Yes, go ahead.
Okay. And I believe that that's quite normal because, of course, English football in 1908, the time that the Olympics were played, was, of course, years ahead of continental football. Just see, the attendance at the FA Cup matches, it was much higher than the attendance of Italian matches or French matches. And he said he wasn't very impressed with France football. He said that it wasn't very developed. He said something interesting about German football. He said that the Germans tried to copy the Austrian, the Czech, the way they played. And the comment is quite interesting because even though he didn't stay in Austria or Czechoslovakia, he mentioned them. That meant that he had very deep knowledge of every single style of every single country. But again, he said that the most influential moment he had, he was in England, he could see how football was really, really, really played. And I would say actually he took inspiration from England. He later coached Italy during the following years.
Thanks for that, Joe, and welcome back from me as well to the podcast. So Pozzo was one of those managers who had an undistinguished playing career I believe he played at Grasshoppers and later at Torino. How was he regarded as a player? Was it an example of a modest player with an obvious good coaching brain, similar to Meisel and Hogan?
Yeah, there are not many comments about Pozzo as a footballer, because when he was in Switzerland, he actually came there to study at the college. And after, almost accidentally, he started playing for the reserve team of Grasshoppers. It wasn't even like the main team. And he only stayed there for like 9 months or 10 months. So there is not much about him available. And all he knew was that, you know, he wasn't regarded as a great player. And then when he came back to Italy, he played 4 or 5 years for Turin. But even there, like, you know, there are not many comments on him as a player. And consider that even his biography doesn't report, like, you know, in what position he played.
Oh, wow.
It was like, you know, between 1906 and 1911. I think I read once that he was a midfielder. But then again, it's not totally clear if he covered that position. And yes, he is in some respects similar to Hugo Meisler and Jimmy Hogan, as you said. Some very important coaches, or regarded as very important coaches, that didn't really have much success as a player. Even Hugo Meisler was a midfielder, and he was called the brain footballer. But actually, he didn't have much success. And after a few years, he retired and became a very important, you know, sporting personality. But as a player, he didn't leave much trace. And the same happened to Pozzo, and the same, I think, happened to Hogan. Hogan, I guess, he played for Bolton and a few other teams. You covered him a few weeks ago with Ashley, and even Hogan wasn't a remarkable player. So, like, you know, they all back, like, you know, they all built their careers coaches.
Yeah, so once he took up coaching, his first stint with the national team was as early as 1912 Olympics, and then later the 1924 Olympics. He didn't have much of an influence at the time, as there was a technical commission that would, I guess, choose the players and so forth, and he would manage them. Can you describe those experiences?
Yes, first of all, it's very important to point out one thing, that before the 20, the 21, before, let's say, the end of the First World War, the coach wasn't regarded as it is nowadays. It was, before, it was a sort of player that was like, you know, both the coach and the player that managed the team. So the role was completely different, and not many countries had a proper coach. What happened was in 1912, it was the first time that Italy experienced that. And Pozzo was one of those personalities that tried to boost football in continental Europe. And yes, he coached Italy, but just actually for one match, because after, like, you know, we lost them. And that match was actually refereed by Meisler. It was Italy against Finland.
Yes.
And so after that, actually, like, you know, he remained in the football field, but mostly as a commissioner, as a journalist, and for many years he hadn't been a coach, because, as you said, Italy was under a commission with many names that, like, you know, succeeded one after another, but, you know, there wasn't a proper coach that stayed in charge for many years. And in 1924, there was a second experiment.
Did he have a larger role than the 1924 one, or was it still the same, like a technical commission?
Now, consider that in 1924 was a moment that Italy wanted to actually rely on a single coach, because a few months before, he got that task, and he was asked, like, you know, to coach Italy in a whole new way, like, independently from other people or a commission. So he accepted them. What happened was that he accepted after Italy suffered a tremendous defeat, 4-0 against Austria. And that's why, like, you know, he was appointed as a coach for the for the Olympics. And it was actually an Olympic that Italy wanted to a new play a part, because in 24 was a year that Italy was getting better and better, and it was very similar to what would later become the World Cup, because there were like teams from South America, as you may know, one of them won it, and there were all the best European teams except for Austria, whose football turned professional the year before.
Right.
So it was like very important.
And we should mention that in 1912, the Italian national team had only been in existence for like 2 years only, in fact. So it was very raw. And I guess by 24, there was a little bit of a, they had a decade of international football under their belt. And they were emerging at this point as a nation, football nation.
So after those Olympics, he worked for Pirelli for a number of years, and he was appointed as Commissario Tecnico in 1929. Did he then have a free hand in terms of team selection, or was there still interference? Was there interference from the fascist authorities at that time?
Yes, consider that he worked for Pirelli for many years, and even before the war, he had a job at Pirelli, and even later. After 1924, he actually thought he wouldn't coach anymore the national team. He thought he would just like work as a journalist and follow football from another side. He did, actually. In 1929, he was convinced, at the end of 1929, by Leandro Pinati, the then commissioner of FIGC, the Italian Federation, to take on the coach role again. So after much pressure from the fascist authorities, maybe he understood he didn't have much choice, and he decided to coach Italy again. After he was fair or not in terms of selection, yes, I think he was, because the main purpose Italy had was to win, was to show the world that, you know, Italian soccer, Italian sport was somehow superior. So they just wanted, like, you know, to work as he could and to call up the players he thought were most suitable. So I think, like, he was quite free in terms of selection. The point was that they knew that after, like, you know, some failures, even because in 28, Italy didn't do bad. Italy got, like, you know, the third first spot in the Olympics. After Uruguay and Argentina, I think the final in 28 was
Uruguay, Argentina.
Okay, yeah, because I got confused with 24, correct. Argentina. And Italy got to the semi-final and lost to Uruguay, that was seen as the best team in the world. So they did quite well. They did quite well, but one has to consider that there were many teams missing, because the best European teams couldn't compete anymore in the Olympics. There was in Brazil. So actually, Italy did well, but that was somehow expected, because the other participants weren't as strong as Italy. So in that moment, it was clear that Italian football could have a boost that later had, both at the national level and the club level. And Maz was appointed again, like, you know, to coach Italy in the years to come.
There are many stories that I've heard about Pozzo's personal and coaching style over the years, mainly through Brian Glanville's columns. One story is that if two players quarreled, he would insist on the pair rooming together so that they would become friends. Is that true?
Well, I read the same thing, so I believe it was true, because I heard the same from another source. So I believe Glanville is very reliable. I think it's something that, you know, many coaches do. I heard the same about Berger in 38. He had the problem of make Austrian and German player coexist. So what he did,
right, the 6+5, I guess, policy.
And I'm pretty sure Pozzo did the same, like him to have a very strong group. So I believe it's completely true. I had heard the same. That was about, like, you know, the way he wanted, like, you know, to create a group. On the other hand, I think he was somehow tough as a coach because he knew he could rely on a very good generation of players. So as soon as a player didn't perform, the player didn't play as he expected them, he knew he could replace him pretty easily. Italy had at least two great players per position in those years. If you see, like, you know, the selection of 34 and the one he had in 38, you notice the teams were very, very different, and they all had plenty of stars. So right. It was like, you know, the golden age of Italian football. Yeah. So maybe somehow he was somehow severe. He was tough because he knew he could, like, you know, he had, like, you know, he was spoiled for choice. He chose as many players he wanted.
Yeah. According to Glanville, Pozzo described himself as tough with a tender hand. Yeah. I'm not sure what that means, but yeah. But he had no qualms, like you said, about dropping his most loyal players. The most striking example is Umberto Carigaris, just ahead of the 1934 World Cup, who had served Pozzo in Italy for like a decade. And also another Italian star, Adolfo Baloncieri, upon when he took over. So, like you said, yes. Was he a tough, heartless selector, or is the truth somewhere in the middle?
No. I think the truth is somehow in the middle. I said, like, the truth is in the halfway, because I said before, he could rely on many, many good players. So if someone didn't perform, he knew he could find a replacement. So it was very hard for him to choose. You should consider that the best Italian team of those years, Bologna, that won twice the World Mitropa Cup, Ambrosiana, Genoa, and other teams, had other great players. So I think, like, you know, he was somehow, he could afford, you know, like, you know, to change players when they didn't perform. What happened with, yeah, and Caligari's got, in 1933, if I'm not mistaken, Caligari got humiliated by Zizek, the Austrian winger. Austria won 4-2, I guess, yes, against Italy in Italy, actually. And, you know, Caligari's had a terrible day against Zizek, and Italy got four goals, suffered four goals. And it said that one of the reasons why he didn't want to rely anymore on Caligari's.
Right.
But I think, like, you know, the main reason is that, you know, the confidence in the national team was very, very high.
Right. In fact, wasn't Caligari's the captain ahead of the World Cup?
Was Caligari's, sorry?
Wasn't he the captain, in fact, ahead of the World Cup? Like, I think for the first match or something against USA.
If he wasn't the captain, he was one of the players with more years of experience under his belt. So I think, like, he was one of the captains, yeah. At least a few times he had been a captain, yes.
Right. Because the whole honor was like, I think, didn't the captain at the time around enter the field with the bandiera, the flag for every match?
Yes.
I think he may have done that against USA. I think he played the first match. I could be wrong. I could check. But I think he played a match against USA, the 7-1 match. But then he was dropped after that. And yeah. And also, like you were saying, Italy had so many players for every position. Just to think, like, someone like Nereo Rocco only played once for Italy. And even, I think, Fulvio Bernardini, he didn't play that many matches either, right? I mean, I know he played. Not but much. Did he?
Another great player that played many years in Rome. Maybe he wasn't lucky because Rome wasn't the best team of Italy at that time, but he was seen as one of, as a great player, yeah. He was called Fufo. Fufo was the nickname. He was a player able to do almost everything on the pitch. He played mostly as a midfielder, but he was very, very versatile as a player. And to connect this question with the question you asked me at the beginning about Pozzo living in England and knowing, like, you know, the English style, one of the things that he wanted to have was, like, in a striker, an English-style striker. He didn't want Meazza to be the number nine, to be the center forward. He wanted, like, in a striker like Schiavio or Pioli in 38. That's why he filled in Meazza a bit backward, because he wanted, like, him to exploit his technique, dribble. And Meazza was never happy because Meazza with Ambrosiana under Arpadvice played as a number nine because Arpadvice had another style. He played with what we call today the false nine. So Meazza had to be somehow sacrificed because Pozzo wanted to have like a stronger striker like Schiavi before and in 38 Piola. And we can say that at the end of the day, he wasn't wrong because Schiavi scored in the final of 1934 and Piola scored the double in 38. So that's one of the things that made him famous. He played especially according to the English style.
In fact, I've read that in here's in year at Manchester, he made contact with the likes of Steve Bloomer, right?
Can be. I'm not sure to be honest about this. I know the Bloomer story. I don't know about the relationship he had with Pozzo.
Oh, okay.
Yeah. Bloomer was in Europe, by the way. He was in Europe in 1914 because he got he was made prisoner. So
right. He was interned. Yeah. Right.
In Ruhelben.
Yeah. And another player that I'd read that Pozzo would made contact with was Charlie Roberts, who was at Manchester United at that time. And he was a player. I mean, he was one of the first players. He was a halfback, but he played in, I guess, what you might call, you know, like a defensive midfielder as well, who also created the play. And that was a similar role that Luis Monti played later on. So maybe there was, you know, there was something in that he'd watched Roberts play in Manchester United, were just emerging as a great team then. I think they might have won the league around the time that the Pozzo was there.
Yeah, that's a very good point. Like, you know, that figure for him was vital. You know, having like in a player in his playing system that was 2-3-5, what you call a metodo, and that player had to have two qualities. He had to be very good at playmaking, and also had to be somehow a defender when the other team attacked. So we had the first Monti, that in Argentina was called Doble Ancho because he was very sturdy and very fit. Doble Ancho is like a sort of closet wardrobe. And he was very good on one hand, but on the other, he was hated by almost every striker because Tindelar had a very good opinion of him. Schiavio, when Bologna toured South America, had a very bad opinion of him, and perhaps John, when asked me this question before about Pozzo being able to make players friends, maybe he referred to that. When Monti was arrived and joined the Italian team, Schiavi and Monti had to make friends because they hated each other because of that tour, like, you know, Bologna took in South America in 1929. And so he was like in a very hard person to deal with, a very hard player to deal with, but he was a great player. In 38, Italy had in that same position another player that was perhaps less defensive than Monti, but he was another Oriundi. Later we'll talk about the Oriundi, and the name was Andrea Olon. He was a player coming from Uruguay, and he covered the same position and role as Monti. Was the central midfield, the center half in the 2-3-5 that Pozzo played.
Yeah, that is an interesting point about the foreign-born players, the Oriundis. So as well as Monti, there was Orsi and Guaita. And Pozzo justified their selection, I believe, saying if they can die for Italy, they can play for Italy. Can you tell us, was there any resistance to the idea of fielding these players from the authorities?
No, actually not, because what happened was, it's quite strange to think, but what happened was that in 1926, Italy enforced La Carta di Viareggio. Carta di Viareggio is the Viareggio chart. Viareggio is a state in Italy, and it was like a law for which Italian teams could field a limit of foreign players. And from 1928 on, that limit was cancelled. Actually, you couldn't field any foreign player. usually foreign players at that time were from Austria, Hungary. So it was decided that Italian teams could have foreign coaches, English, Hungarian, Austrian, but no foreign players. So an escapade, this law was that Italian teams could sign players having Italian relatives, Italian parents. So players that were born in another country, but bearing an Italian surname. That was when, like, you know, the first one was Giulio Libonati in 1928, who debuted for Italy very, very soon. And Pozzo was somehow skeptical about introducing Oriundi into the Italian team because he was fearing the reactions from the authorities. So he asked Leandro Pinati how he could deal with that situation because he wanted to field Orsi, for instance, which was regarded as one of the best left wingers Italy had. And Pinati said, there is no problem for the Italian law. You can field as many Oriundi you want because they actually have Italian parents, Italian relatives. So according to our law, they are regarded as Italians. And that was when Italy started having many, many Oriundis. Perhaps, like, you know, people know the best ones, the one that had the greatest impact on the team, like Orsi, Guaita, Monti, Andreolo, and a few others. But every Italian team had plenty of Oriundis. Lazio, it wasn't seen as a great team in that time. At a certain point was nicknamed Brazil Lazio because they played many players from Brazil. And but every team had many Oriundi players. Now, while writing my second book about the Mitropa, I noticed how many Oriundi Inter Ambrosiana had. We had De Maria, an Argentinian player. We had Ferrione, a player born in Uruguay. Napoli's first international scorer was Sallusto, who was born in Paraguay. Roma had many Oriundi like Scopelli, like Lombardo, like Guaita, of course, and some others. So every Italian team had plenty of Oriundi because the law actually allowed them to sign players from South America, provided that they had an Italian surname.
Yeah. So that they had to prove evidence, right? It's not just, it was just done on paper. They had to actually have proof that they have Italian ancestry to be able to play for the national team. Is that correct?
Yes. Yeah, right. Exactly. Sometimes you could even have a foreign surname if provided that, like, you know, you got Italian citizenship many years before. There are a few cases of players with Italian foreign sounding surnames that played for Italy because they got the citizenship many years before. Otherwise, like, you know, they had to prove you had Italian background. Otherwise, there was no way to play for Italy.
Right.
And were the clubs actively scouting South America at that time then to look for these players, or were they players that were already known from playing?
Well, the best players from South America were known because, of course, after the 1930 World Cup, everyone knew that, you know, Argentinian and Uruguayan football was the best after England, perhaps. So, like, you know, the best players were known and, you know, generally was strong both in South America and Italy. So I think it's quite sure that Monti was wanted by Mussolini. So, like, you know, the best players were known. And sometimes teams got aware of other good players because they toured South America, or South American teams came to Europe to play. So it was quite easy, like, you know, to understand the best players were. One was, like, you know, Stabile. Stabile was the main scorer in the 1930 World Cup. Guillermo Stabile had, of course, Italian origins because Stabile is an Italian surname. He didn't have to play. He wasn't supposed to play the 1930 World Cup because Argentina had three strikers ahead of him. For some reasons, some of them got injured. Some had some troubles. And in the end, Stabile became, like, you know, the starter in that position. He scored many goals. And after the World Cup, he came to Genova to play to play for Genoa. So yeah, it became something like, you know, very common to sign players from other South American nations.
In fact, Orsi was signed right after the 1928 Olympics. I think he even went back to Argentina. He just signed him right there, I think.
That's another reason, because in the Olympics you could see, like, you know, Uruguay, Argentina, so you got to know very quickly, like, you know, who the best players were.
Right. Yeah. Another topic that comes up about Pozzo, because of the time that it lived in, was about how political of a man was he. It's somewhat unclear if he really was a fascist himself or not. He did, however, use that type of patriotism to his advantage. The most referenced story is during the 1938 World Cup match, I believe, versus France, the host nation. He knew that the Italian national anthem was going to be jeered by the Italian expatriates, I guess, opposed to the regime. So he instructed his team to maintain the fascist salute, I guess, when the national anthems were played, until all the boos died down. First of all, is this story true? And do you know of other similar examples? And just politically, was he a true believer, or did he just use it for sporting advantage?
First question, was Pozzo a fascist or not? No, he wasn't. As he recalled in the biography, he never had the membership of the fascist party. He never had it, which is quite incredible, considering that sometimes in Italy, Germany, all these countries, even though you weren't a fascist, you had the membership because it was convenient for you to have the membership. So, like, a burger wasn't known to be a Nazi, but Weber had the National Socialism membership, because for him it was useful to have it. Pozzo never had it. And unfortunately, even nowadays, people regard him as a fascist, because he was the Italy's coach under fascism. And for many years, decades, he never had a stadium dedicated to him, something he deserved, of course, after winning so much, because his image was associated to the fascist party.
All right.
To answer this question, he wasn't a fascist at all. Now there is, like, in a small pitch in Biella, near his hometown, dedicated to him. I saw it with my own eyes when I went to Biella. Yeah. Couple of years ago, but it's a very small one, so it's not nothing important.
I mean,
and the second question was about that match. Yes, that's true, but one has to consider that many of those things happen not because of Pozzo, but because of the Italian authorities.
Oh, so they told him to that, okay, you know, so somebody was instructed by the authorities that he had to comply with, essentially.
Well, it's possible, if I'm not mistaken. In 1938 World Cup, Italy played one match with the black...
Yes, against France, yeah.
I'm pretty sure that didn't depend on Pozzo or something that the Italian Federation wanted to apply.
Yeah. Well, I mean, France were the host nation. They were wearing blue, and I guess the all-black shirt was, I guess, the... so to speak, the away strip. I think they had worn it like maybe a couple of weeks before against Yugoslavia, if I'm not mistaken. But so they would, regardless, they would have had to wear a away strip. But you're saying the all black one, maybe just a form of provocation politically, you think? That's why they had decided.
The main version was that it was somehow provocation. Yeah. Consider that in 38, fairly, French people hated us because it was clear that in a few months Italy would turn to Nazism. So every time Italy played, we got booed for the 90 minutes. And Italy won that World Cup. And at the end, the French audience finally applauded Italy, because Italy proved to be, like, you know, the best team in the world in 38. Right. But in 34, there were many suspicions about, you know, how the World Cup ended. And our position politically was you know, was it like, you know, the best you could have.
Right, right. And I guess my other question was, if there are other examples similar to this that you, that's, that maybe non-Italian audiences don't know.
The same can be said about Germany, about Germany. Consider that Herberger played with this team, you know, of course, like wearing this swastika.
Right, right. Jersey.
And they were as whistled as Italy, if not more, because of course, like, you know, everyone, no one liked them at that time. Right. And yeah, actually it was a failure because they lost to Switzerland. And other similar episodes like 38, it's hard because 38 is 1 year exactly before the Second World War. So after that, or before that, we didn't have, like, you know, similar situations. No, I don't think so. I don't think so, to be honest. Even because in 34, we were under fascism, but it was somehow, like, you know, a stable situation. You know, the war wasn't, like, you know, upcoming. So,
right, right.
I think, like, you know, what happened in 38 was somehow unique. Yeah.
Right. Also, I think, remember when Miazza went to pick up the World Cup trophy after the final? And I forgot who, the French president who's handing him trophy. There was a lot of, issue when he gave him the fascist salute before picking it up. Was there any, that was just considered normal that an Italian would do that around at this time? Or
was completely acceptable in Italy because that was, like, you know, the way, like, you know, players are, like, right. And during the 1938 World Cup, it happened before every match.
Right, before right. Match.
And when foreign teams came to Italy to play some matches, it was somehow, like, you know, something normal, like, you know, to make the fascist salute.
Right.
So it was, like, yeah, the question there was that you were a host.
And, right.
Maybe you shouldn't have, like, you know, performed that salute, but
right.
In Italian, it was somehow, yeah, no.
Well, I guess, Paul, obviously, you know, the example of the England national team with Germany, I guess in 1938, was it, in fact, where they were forced to, I guess, the English ambassador, I guess, begged them or something to make the fascist salute ahead of their match against German national team. So a lot of times, I guess, the players were basically just pawns with the authorities of various nations. And incidentally, I guess, Paul, that England match, apparently the next day, Aston Villa had a friendly in Germany and they were asked to do the same thing, but they ignored it. And I guess nothing was made out of that. But I guess with the national team, obviously there's more spotlight. Maybe that's, you know, why they had to, you know. And that's been discussed over the years as well, whether who's at to blame for that. I mean, but you would know better than I guess, Paul.
I think they were under a lot of pressure to do that. As you say, the players wouldn't have really been able to make that decision for themselves and, you know, possibly could have affected their futures, you know, who would have known. I think it's a shame, obviously, in this period, it's difficult for us to separate the football from the politics.
Right.
Which we would all prefer to do, but certainly at that time, is, you know, Pozzo was under certain constraints and certain pressure, and, you know, the England team in that particular match obviously were as well, and they were basically following whatever the government or in the form of the ambassador was telling them to do.
Well, I think it's very hard to say no because you always fear about the consequences. Of not doing, like, you know, the fascist salute, the Nazi salute. We have a player here called Bruno Neri that once before a match refused to make the Nazi salute, to the fascist salute. And there are books written about him. I don't know his story very, very well, but there are a few cases of players that didn't accept to do the Nazi, to do the fascist salute. Even in 38, before Germany played the last match against Austria, the teams gathered, like, you know, on the midfield line and made the fascist salute, of course, because it was a celebration match, let's say. So I think it's very hard to say no when you have in front of you like the authorities. And after all, you're playing just like in a football match. So, like, you know, it's very hard to say. Maybe no one would be killed for that, of course, but you might not play anymore for the national team. You might be somehow...
persona non grata, yeah.
Yeah, exactly, yeah. So sometimes it's very hard to deal with the regimes. Just consider what happened, like, you know, with in Hungary in the 50s. One player was killed. Many others escaped. Some of them risked, like, you know, to lose their lives. So, you know, players know that, you know, when they have to deal with the regimes, they have to be very careful.
Going back to earlier in Pozzo's career, you mentioned that he'd studied in different European countries and obviously, you know, had the language skills. So he had a lot of connections with other countries and managers. Can you describe his relationship with Hugo Meisel, of the manager of the Austrian Wunder Team?
Yes, actually, there was a great mutual respect between them. Great mutual respect. They had pretty much the same career. They were all around the professional in football. They were coaches, they were journalists, they were managers. So, like, you know, there was mutual respect. And they both had a great knowledge of football. Great. They knew the style of every country. And I'm pretty sure the first time they met was in the 1912 Olympics, when he said in his biography that Pozzo approached Meisel after the match between Finland and in Italy, because he was surprised of the way Meisel interacted with Italian players. So Pozzo came closer and asked him, "How do you speak Italian so well?" And Meisel told him that that he had been to Trieste a few years before. So they had a chat, and then Meisel introduced them, the Austrian players, to Pozzo. And Pozzo was struck about the fact that many Austrian players actually came from Bohemia, Czechoslovakia. All their surnames were from Czechoslovakia. And that was, like, you know, one of the main differences between the two countries. Italy, in 12, had all players born and raised in Italy, versus Austria had, like, you know, many players coming from every corner of the empire. And that was the first moment when they met. Both countries at that time weren't, like, you know, footballing powers, because, of course, Italy and Austria were years behind England, of course, because England was professional already. They had, like, a much higher level. But they both were intentioned, you know, to make the local football increase and improve. So what happened was that they both had the same problem in 1914, because, like, you know, the First World War, you know, broke out. So, like, you know, they had to interrupt their plans. And they were started after in 1918. Of course, Italy and Austria fought the war on two opposite sides, opposite positions, of course. But I don't think this somehow changed the relationship. I think, like, you know, they kept the respect they had for each other. And the only moment which is somehow different is when in 1934, Meisel said to have left the field after the semifinal against Italy. Some people said that he was very angry at the defeat, and he decided to leave the field without shaking hands with Pozzo. But of course, like, you know, it didn't depend on Pozzo, no? It depended on the fact that he was very disappointed for the defeat. The Austrian players were really enraged for what happened at the end of the match. So I think, like, you know, it was, like, you know, they were very similar in so many ways, and I think, like, you know, had a very good relationship.
Can you also describe his relationship with Herbert Chapman?
Okay, yeah. Well, yeah, let's say with Herbert, yeah, it was somehow similar to the one he had with Meisel. The main difference was that they didn't have many contacts because in that time Germany wasn't as important as Austria. So Italy rarely played against Germany. Italian teams almost never faced German teams. So like, you know, they didn't have much contact. Herberger was another coach regarded as one of the most influential coaches in Europe. But the main difference was that Herberger appeared in the European scene much after Pozzo and Meist, because actually Herberger became a coach of Germany after Otto Nerz, and after Otto Nerz was eliminated from the Olympics in 1936. Seen as a great coach after 1934 because they got a third spot in the World Cup. 1936, it was a complete failure. So that was when Herberger, like, you know, appeared as a coach. So that was the main difference. Like, you know, he wasn't a pioneer, right, as Pozzo and Meist were. As for Chapman, I think, like, you know, Pozzo's style was somehow similar to Chapman because they both, like, you know, advocated the same style. They both advocated the English style, and they played in a somehow similar way, while Meisler seemed to be more influenced by the Scottish style, the passing game, combination of soccer, versus England and Italy adopted another style.
Herbert Chapman, he passed away in 1935, I believe, right? Or thereabouts, I'm not sure. Right. But so, as far as the Battle of Highbury, that match, was it Herbert Chapman who kind of arranged for Italy to play that match in 1934? Through his connections with Pozzo?
It can be. I'm not sure, to be honest.
Would you know about that, Paul? Whether Herbert Chapman was influential in arranging that match through his connections with Pozzo?
Yeah, I'm not sure. We'd have to double check on this. I think that Chapman might have died earlier that year.
1934?
I think he died quite suddenly. So whether the match was already arranged, obviously it was played at Highbury and lots of Arsenal players involved. We'd have to double check that.
No, I'm sure that he was very, like, when Austria played England in London in 1932, I'm pretty sure that Chapman arranged everything. He arranged a hotel for the Austrian team. He was in contact with Meisel, and he was very important because he put at the disposal of the Austrian team, like, you know, the Arsenal's playing ground, training ground. But I'm not sure about 1934.
Right. Yeah, so I guess all those high-level coaches, there was like a fraternity, basically. Like very, I guess they helped each other for the promotion of the game. And, you know.
Exactly, yeah. One of the differences was that Herberger had a different playing style. He played with the 3-2-5, the system, Sistema.
This is Herbert. Who's this again?
Herberger.
Okay, so he played for exactly. Right.
And in 1938, he was about to switch to 2-3-5 to method, but he didn't. And in the end, he just decided to keep the 3-2-5 and calling up some Austrian strikers because they didn't have to get adapted from the 2-3-5 because strikers were played pretty much in the same way. There was a discussion between the 2-3-5 or the 3-2-5. Because some people in Germany thought it was a good idea to switch to another tactics. And other thought it was not correct because you would, like, you know, somehow change too much, like, you know, the way the team played. So, but actually, like, you know, there was this discussion with playing philosophies, you know, that were popular in those years, Sistema and Method. So that was the main difference. Tactically speaking, about Pozzo and Herberger.
So on the tactical front, was there any tactical evolution or any particular innovations that you would say Pozzo himself had brought to the game? Was there any sort of trademark tactic that he used?
In my opinion, Pozzo wasn't an innovator, tactically speaking. I can't see, like, you know, something specific that would say he was an innovator. I can see, for instance, in Sabes, Hungary Sabes. I can see it in Chapman. I can see it in the Austrian Wunderteam. Pozzo, to me, wasn't really an innovator. I think he was quite loyal to the, well, he used, like, you know, the methadone. He was a really great supporter of the methadone, even when the methadone started, like, you know, to be a bit obsolete. But he always thought the methadone was, like, you know, his way of playing. And again, like, you know, the way he managed the striking line was very similar to what many English teams did, with a central striker. And so if you ask me about the innovations brought by Pozzo, I think he was more important, like, you know, as a coach. Yeah, maybe he was a great motivator. He was even somehow lucky to have so many good players. And he was very important as a pioneer of the game. That's true. But I don't think he was really an innovator, because I don't see really in the team what innovation he really brought.
So Pozzo remained in charge during the Warriors, where Italy essentially played matches against Germany and, I guess, all the German quote-unquote puppet states, say Croatia or other nations like that. So he remained in charge after the end of the war for a few years. And right before the Superga disaster, which basically is a reference point as far as the end of that Italian generation, his greatest, I guess his lowest ebb was when in 1948 Italy lost to England 0-4. Was it a situation where he felt that he just could do no more, or was he pushed out because he'd been there for like almost 20 years, or how was he regarded? What was the reason he left?
Well, the reason was, I think, like, primarily the result. 4-0 in a friendly match that wasn't like any other friendly match, because it was the 50th anniversary of the Fiji Chi. So it was like, you know, a match that had to be a sort of celebration, and the stadium was actually, like, you know, widened to contain more spectators, and a lot of money were invested, like, you know, to make everything. So it was an event that had to somehow to testify the progress that Italian football made. And the very bad idea that Barassi, the Fiji Chi chairman, had was to invite England. And they had players like Finney, Mortensen, that scored, I think, like all the goals, so 3 goals out of 4. And another question emerged, that was like, should Italy switch to Sistema, to 3-2-5, or should Italy go on with 2-3-5? Grande Torino, that was like the reference team in those years, played with the system quite similar to Hungary, to Puskas Hungary. 3-2-5, but a dynamic 3-2-5. And Pozzo was still convinced of using the 2-3-5. And that match played against England. England used the stopper and used the system, 3-2-5, proved them perhaps that somehow had to be changed. So Pozzo's ideas were regarded as outdated. So even though Italy had a great team, because Grande Torino was a great team, the idea should be that Italy had to resemble Grande Torino, even from a tactical point of view. So after Superga, well, in 1949, the Superga disaster happened. And the year after the World Cup was played, and hadn't the disaster happened, Italy would have played in Brazil with perhaps 9 or 10 out of 11 players of Grande Torino. And Italy could have been one of the favorites, one of the, you know, forerunners, you know, to win the World Cup. But I think, like, you know, yeah, it was somehow a moment when we realized that a change had to be made, even though Pozzo was still seen as a reference, but you know, it had to change somehow the way we played.
And what became of Pozzo after that? Joe, what was his later life or his later career?
After that, I think like he didn't have much of an influence after that. I can't remember if he still coached. I'm not sure. I think like you know that was his his sporting event that is the latest associated to him was preferred in 1949 because he was the person who identified like you know the bodies. Italian players the Torino players that died in Superga. He also recognized the body of Erbstein, the coach of Grande Torino. And after that, I'm not sure if he took like you know some minor roles in football. Maybe he did. I'm not sure, but I think
he was a journalist, right? For the rest after.
Yeah,
that,
perhaps he remained in football, but only as a journalist. That was actually his plan in the 20s before he was called again by Urbinati. But yeah, he didn't coach anymore any other team. And I think like, you know, his popularity somehow faded because everything that happened under fascism here is somehow underestimated. We, you know, after the Second World War, it was everyone wanted to take some distance from that period. And they wanted like, you know, to perhaps to cancel what happened like, you know, during the war. But actually, like, even nowadays, if you talk to Italian people about the 1934 World Cup, the 1938 World Cup, many of them will tell you that, you know, we weren't that good, we won because of Mussolini, etc. And the same is said about Alpinati, about Bologna, and even about Pozzo. But of course, we had a very good generation of players. It was a moment that Italian football really grew. So I think like you have to separate politics from football and on a footballing point of view, I think like you know what Italy did in the interwar years was somehow great and incredible. So it is really a shame that Pozzo didn't have a stadium dedicated to him, an important stadium like Meazza has, because as you might know, like nowadays our stadium is dedicated to. The stadium where I went many times because of watching Inter Milan is dedicated to Meazza. And there is nothing like that with four Vittorio Pozzo.
Yeah, I was going to say, when you were saying that Italians today are trying to distance themselves from the fascist era, players like Meazza or Piola are still regarded as heroes of Italian football, I'm assuming to this day. Yet somehow it's surprising that Vittorio Pozzo isn't. And in fact, I'm just wondering, do Italians today, like they say, the young Italian fan, are they aware of Pozzo and his legacy, or is just someone from the past that they don't, an afterthought almost?
I think most of them heard the name at least once because, like, you know, you hear the name of Vittorio Pozzo. But many of them don't know where he lived, what he won, and they didn't know, like, in the whole story as we summarized today. Because they're not much interested in what happened, like, you know, 50, 60, 70 years ago. Unfortunately, because if they were, I would sell more copies of my books. But unfortunately, they're not.
Even 20 years ago, even 20 years ago, some of them probably don't remember.
Yes, also consider there is no way actually to see how those players played. All I know of Meazza or Piola, I know because I read many chronicles, I read many comments, so I think I got an idea of like you know how these players played, but of course I don't have any video, I don't have any clip to check how they played. But that's one of the reasons why my people are not really interested, because in the end they think yes, but I will never realize how they played because I have no way to see them playing. So it's very hard like you know to guess how Meazza was without a clip. But I think after studying and reading, you can get an idea. I think.
Yeah, we should mention that Pozzo passed away, I believe, in 1968, if I'm not mistaken. Exactly. Yeah. And I'm just wondering, did he receive a state funeral, or is it just, like you said, people try to distance themselves?
I'm sure he got some recognition as a soldier after the war, after the First World War.
Oh, that's right, that's right. He served in the First War.
Yes. On a sporting point of view, it might be, would have to check, I'm not sure.
I'm very interested about his trip to, I guess, his Manchester years. In the sense, like I know you said the story about Bloomer, that may you can't, that not many people can confirm, but I'm just wondering if his year, I guess his years at Manchester, surely that had an effect on him as far as his football brain. And I'm just wondering if maybe we could expand on that.
Yes, I think as far as I know, the reason was that football in England was a completely another sport. In 1908, when English teams came to the continent to play, the main result was a 6-0 for the English sides. It was much more developed. And of course, after being in Italy, Switzerland, and England, I'm sure he noticed the difference, because the difference was huge. So I think, like, you know, he said he was very impressed about English football. I can't remember exactly how long he stayed. I think he stayed in Manchester for, I can't remember exactly how many years he spent there.
Yeah, exactly what years would those be, by the way? Like, you think?
Sorry?
Around what years would he have been at Manchester?
I would have to check it. I don't remember exactly. No? But I don't know for sure.
I'm assuming probably the first decade of the century, but anyway, I could be wrong.
Yeah, I think so. Yeah.
Yeah.
I think, like, you know, there was, like, you know, the common perception that at that time, like, you know, if you want, like, you know, to get better, to improve your national team, you have to see what happened in England, because it was like my reference from everyone.
Right, right.
And the difference was, it was like, you know, 30 years ahead. So, like, you could see everything at a better level.
Right.
The player's pace, the technique, tactics. I'm pretty sure that both Meisel and Pozzo started from there, from observing what happened in England.
Right. And my other question is, how did he have such a clout that even as early on as like 1912 or so, like, he was selected as national team manager, and of course they came back for him, I guess, later in 1929. How is it that he had such a clout as a coach?
Well, consider that in those years, and the same can be said about Hugo Meisler, it was very unusual to bank on football, because it wasn't a business. So many people actually didn't dedicate time to football. And it wasn't very common to become a journalist, to coach a team, to play for a team, to be so persistent in doing that, in doing so without seeing the results. So many players of those years, I'm thinking of Pozzo, Maestro, even maybe Jimmy Hogan. No, Jimmy Hogan, no, because he was English, which is different. But many other figures, like Guillemot, the Hungarian player, that then became, like, you know, the chairman of the federation. They did that without seeing a single cent for years. That project, now, like, you see, football sounds great, something like that, really. The most popular sport in the continent at that time. It was, you see, like, you know, the attendance at matches in 1910, 1912, you see that very, very few people came to the to watch the matches. And Pozzo, even in those days where football wasn't a thing in Italy, was very, very well informed, had been to England, and it wasn't very common, like, you know, to have studied every single style in so many nations as he did. So I think, actually, like, you know, he had the knowledge, he had the culture about football that very, very, very few people had. Mm. you know, going to England would be that, you know, you got something very educational, because you could see, like, you know, how football was played, and he could compare, like, you know, different philosophies. You know, nowadays it's very common, like, you know, to go to a country, make an experience, but at that time it wasn't. So I think, like, you know, that mind frame was very uncommon, like, you know, to people. So what Pozzo knew was something unique, I think.
You know, if he continued to follow English football through his career, obviously England and Italy played it, you know, several times. We've mentioned a few of the matches. But do you know if he kind of followed developments in English football all the way through his career? Or was that just an early phase of his life?
No, I'm pretty sure he did. The point is, he actually didn't have much chances to play against England at an official level, because, of course, as you know, the first World Cup England played was in 1950. That was like 2 years after Pozzo was, because after that defeat, like, you know, Italy changed his technical, his coach. So they didn't have a chance to play the World Cup one again another. So, but yeah, I'm pretty sure in the 30s, you already could observe somehow like a competition between England and other teams in 32. Like, you know, Austria got very close to win a match against England. And maybe English football was still the best, but the difference was slim. Before the 30s, I wouldn't know the difference between England and South American teams, because Uruguay in the 20s was a great, great squad. But before, the difference was huge. And if you see the... Well, we had a check at the Oldham tour of Hungary and Austria some time ago. And that match ended in a draw, I think, Ferencváros against Oldham, 1-1, I think. But in that tour, many English teams came to Europe, and some of them won against Hungarian, Austrian, or even Italian teams, like 6-0, like Blackburn, 7-0, 8-0. In the 30s, I think, like, there was less that Italians, Austrians, and Hungarians had to learn from England, because deciding years were before, of course. After that, it was like more common for English teams to develop their own playing style. But in the 10, of course, like, you know, there was much. Actually, like, you know, I think coaches like John Dick, John Madden, Jimmy Hogan, Herbert Burgess, and many others, when they came to Europe, they didn't just come with the intention of coaching. I think they came first with the intention of teaching. Because Italian teams, Italians, or the Europeans didn't really know what football was. I mean, they were starting to learn it, but, you know, they had, like, you know, some very basic knowledge of it. And after, in the 30s, when a coach came to Italy, he knew he would come to teach a team that was already well-trained. The Italian movement was professional, so there was less to teach and more to coach, perhaps. But before, the world was somehow different.
And he was there, and he was right in the centre of it. If he was in Manchester, obviously, both Manchester clubs, Liverpool not far away, Blackburn, Bury, Oldham, they were all the sort of powerhouses of English football, so he'd have been able to observe all those teams at that time. He was in the right place to do so.
Right. Joe, earlier you said that there were no... I guess, tactical innovations from Pozzo. Is his contribution perhaps the fact that he installed a winning mentality culture to the national team, perhaps?
Yes, I believe so. I think, like, the whole Italian movement was developing fast at the time. And investment were harder because football turned into the sport of the masses, the sport of the crowds. So stadiums were built, stadiums were increased, and Pozzo had great football knowledge. I mean, like, I'm not saying he didn't. He had a very good football knowledge under many points of view, maybe he was a very good motivator. Maybe he was a very good group maker. He was very good in into like piece together like the players, and he was even, I would say that there was even a percentage of luck in the sense that in those years Italy had many great players. If I think of a player like Carlo Guzzoni, like Italy's left winger, who played at Bologna, he almost never played in the national team because that position was taken by Orsi. But if I think about other players, like there are many players that didn't have a chance to play for the national team that were very high level. So he was even a bit lucky. I'm not saying that he didn't have any merit. Deserved, like, you know, his reputation, but he was somehow lucky because he got, like, you know, this to train, like, you know, this very good generation of players. So yeah, the winning mentality is something that makes you a very good motivator, of course, but it's not something that has to do with football, you know. That's something that can apply to a number of fields, to a number of disciplines, and maybe he had this quality, of course. On a tactical point of view, really, if you ask me, like, you know, the innovators I can spot in football, I wouldn't say Pozzo, I would say other coaches.
Yeah. Also, we should mention that Pozzo, I guess, when in 1929 he was appointed, I guess, for full time at this point, that was also the first season of Calcio. The first season of the Italian league, and its importance to the Italian national team, in fact, to the culture of Italy as a whole. And I'm sure Pozzo greatly benefited from how it just took off from the onset, and all the players who played at such a high level that he had at his disposal, basically checking them out week after week. And so do you think which one was more beneficial? Was a cultural beneficial of Pozzo, or is a Pozzo beneficial of Calcio at this point?
It's a very good question. It's a very good question. That year was the first championship we had, as we say here, with Girone Unico. Girone Unico was that we only had one championship. We didn't have one from the north, one from the south. We just had one. And it looked like pretty much like nowadays championship. And in that year, because of that, Italy's his request to join the Mitropa was accepted. So finally, we could see Italian teams playing against the other European sides. And in 1929, Bologna was already a great team. So we also could make comparisons year after year by seeing Italian players and teams against Austrian, Hungarian, Czechoslovakian. So it wasn't like before that we could just, like, you know, make comparison by watching the national teams playing against one another. Right. And it was another defining moment, because finally we got an idea of what country was the best or what country was the worst, etc. To answer your question, I think I believe that Pozzo was very beneficial to Italian football in the first, because without a figurehead like Pozzo, it's hard to imagine that kind of development. He was really persistent in his mission to make football what it is known now, because just in Germany, football remained amateur until, I think, the 60s.
Yeah, until the Bundesliga, like 1963.
Bundesliga. Except if you think that without any perspective, perspective or without any certainty of success, people like Meisel, Pozzo, did whatever they could to promote football and to make it become something, a business, in other terms. I think, like, you know, what he did for football was invaluable, I think.
Right. Michel Platini was once asked about the contrast in how Calcio is so huge in Italy, whereas culturally, football in France still lagged behind. And his response was that if for Italians, you know, football was born in 1934 when they won the World Cup. With us, it was when Saint-Étienne reached the Champions Cup final in 1976. So we've always had like this 40-year gap. So I guess Pozzo is in a way maybe responsible as well for that, how culturally calcio is the staple of the Italian culture, and you know, and is part of the Italian life basically, and yeah, it must have something to do with that.
Yeah, actually, it's well, Pozzo himself said when he went to France that he wasn't impressed at all by French football. He praised the English, he praised the German, and he never praised the French. So yeah, France has been hasn't been a footballing powers for many years. I think they, even in the 60s, 70s, they never had like, you know, any.
Right, and I'm not even speaking about like, I mean, they've won titles over the years. My point was like more in a cultural sense. In a cultural sense, culture in Italy is everything, whereas it's probably not the number one thing in France. You know what I mean? Like that was a contrast he was trying to make. You know.
Probably it was actually. It is very hard, like, you know, to judge football in the 20s, 30s here, because all you can do is read newspaper. But you know, as far as I could read, like it turned into something very, very, very big. Yeah. Maybe France it wasn't the same. Yeah. Here it was like, you know, already something very, very important. And also in Italy had a peculiarity that football was very widespread in many cities, in many regions, in many cities. And that was quite unique in Europe, because the same couldn't be said for Austria or other countries, or the football was played in the main capital.
Right.
They had, like, you know, the best teams from Vienna, Budapest or Prague. Versus in Italy, we had football was played at the highest level in Milan, Roma, Bologna, Genoa, Torino. Maybe that was another reason. Yeah, so it was something like, you know, on a national scale.
So I guess we can conclude that he's definitely, Pozzo is definitely a trendsetter, definitely a historical figure of football in general, and not just Italian football. And I keep going back to this fact that he's the only manager to have won the World Cup twice, and that's that may stay a record that may stay there for, you know, for the rest of our lives, for all I know. But it seems to be very, I mean, nowadays managers, national team managers, have a lifespan of like 3-4 years basically.
Exactly.
And when you think he stayed like 20 years plus a couple of stints before that, you know, you don't see that often, you know.
And now it would be somehow unthinkable, I think, because there is much pressure from the press, from the supporters,
right,
as soon as the coach maybe facing a competition, everyone wants him replaced.
Right.
That time you had time to build the project. There was not much pressure because Italy wasn't expected to win.
Right.
And nowadays, if you don't qualify for a World Cup, you're fired.
Right.
This happened with Ventura.
Right. Yeah. That's something that we never imagined to see in our lifetime. Italy not in a World Cup, but that's another story.
It happened, unfortunately.
Yes. Yeah. So, yeah. What's your takeaway, Paul, from all this?
Yes, it's very interesting. Pozzo is one of those figures, the name's known and his achievements are known, but not that much, I don't think, has been written or, you know, said about his whole career. And it's very interesting to hear how that developed, and that he was a student of the game in different countries and brought that and had that opportunity to shape a national team. Because that's the other thing that that England didn't have, although there were managers like Herbert Chapman. The national team was still picked by committee right up until Alf Ramsey taking over. So it was very different to have this figurehead. And by the sound of it, it was more or less him that he was able to pick a team without too much interference at that time. So he really shaped Italy into that team. And as well as the two World Cups is impressive in itself. But it, they were quite different teams, weren't they, as well? There were a lot of changes. He didn't just rely on the one set of players that had won.
Right. In fact, only two players from 1934 were in the 1938 team, Miazza and Ferrari. Yeah.
So he'd reshaped the team almost completely, which is, you know, very impressive as well. Yeah, it's been fascinating learning more about his whole career.
And in fact, it's kind of lost in the discussion that he took a very raw Italian team at the 1936 Olympics and won there as well. I mean, all the players he took were basically uncapped, you know.
And yeah, 36 is another story because, of course, like, you know, many teams went to that competition without the best players, you know, like, you know, you couldn't field them professional players. What Pozzo did, then, that's an important point that we didn't touch, but we have now to talk about it. He was able because he could pick players who were students at the time. They were enrolled into universities or colleges, like Annibale Ferrozzi, that became the goal scorer of that tournament, Rava, and a few others. And that way, like, you know, he could use them for the national team. And in that way, like, you know, also won the German Olympics. So, yeah. But that competition, I think, has to be seen differently because in 36, the Olympics weren't like, I mean, if you see Austria, for instance, it wasn't the Wunderteam. If you see England, of course, England didn't came to the Olympics with the best. They almost raced, like, you know, to lose against China. That they got the gold disallowed. Then they won 2-0, I think. They got the gold disallowed. So that was a very important competition. But
yeah, well, it's an achievement nonetheless to have won the World Cup and the Olympic title.
Yeah, and not only that, even the International Cup twice.
Oh, yeah. Also, the International Cup, is that the Dr. Gero Cup?
Yeah, the last edition of the International Cup was called Dr. Gero because Gero went to the concentration camp and then he survived. But he was another very important figure. Gero, another prize, etc. International Cup was like a sort of a European Cup of the interwar years.
Well, we've learned much, and I'm sure there's even much to learn about Pozzo, and we just scratched the surface. Yeah. Any final thoughts?
Paul?
No, just thank you for, you know, shedding more light on you know, one of the great managers and, you know, giving us a lot more information than we had before about him. Thank you. It's been very interesting.
Right. I'm assuming there's an autobiography of him and probably some books written about him, but nothing in English, I doubt. But
no, it's a biography, not an autobiography.
Oh,
but
sorry,
there are many. No, but there are many comments from him, so it's very, very reliable. Yes, it would be great sometimes to make a sort of, you know, language exchange and translating books for the Italian market, for the English market, like, you know, to expand the knowledge of some. The book here, the book I have reports so. Your listeners can say, but you can, I think. Author is Mauro Garibaldi. Can you say it?
Right.
Okay. And it's a very good book, actually. Yeah, I just read a part.
What's the title again?
A Storia di un Italiano, History of an Italian.
Oh, I see.
To find an English publisher, we can think of translating for the English market, and that would be great.
Of course.
Yeah. But yeah, I think that's the only book about specifically about sports. There is another one about the national team, which of course talks a lot about specifically on him. This is the only one.
Thank you for the interview and all the things we learned. I want to thank Mr. Araf for his participation again, and always feel free to leave questions and comments. For any questions and comments, you may contact myself on the blog. I'm on Twitter. I'm on SP1873, and on Facebook, I'm under Soccer Nostalgia. Mr. Paul Whittle can be contacted on Twitter at 1888 letter. And you also follow the podcast on Spotify under Soccer Nostalgia Talk Podcast. Mr. Araf's contact info is linked to the blog and the Spotify. It's connected to his book, Generazione Wunderteam. So I guess once again, thank you, Joe. Thank you. And hope we continue these discussions and learn more about the history of the game.
Thanks, John. Thanks, Paul. And again, sorry for the technical issues I had.
We'll try to fix those.
Okay.
Thank you, Joe.
Thank you.